Let's pray together. Lord, we open our hearts and minds to the inspiration of your Spirit. Guide us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Hold us, Lord. That in times like these, when the water's coming down from the sky, and the days are uncertain because we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, we cling to your unchanging hand, that hand that is made in love, that hand that pours out grace, that hand that gave us Jesus, that hand that has given us forgiveness. We give you thanks for this day, Lord, that we're able to come together in your name and just to give you praise, glory, and honor. You made this day, and it's a wonderful day to be alive. So wake us up into your spirit, Lord, that we might be able from this church to go out into the whole of Greensboro and spread the word that you are a good God who is ever alive and you have not died, but you are here. And because you live, we thrive every day. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Our scripture lesson this morning comes from Matthew 22, verses 23 through 33. You can find it in the Pew Bible on page 857. Again, that's Matthew 22, verses 23 through 33. The same day, Sadducees came to him who say that there is no resurrection, and they ask him a question, saying, "Teacher, Moses said, if a man dies having no children, his brother must marry the widow and raise up children for his brother. Now there were seven brothers among us. The first married and died, and having no children, left his wife to his brother. So to the second and third, down to the seventh. After them all, the woman died. In the resurrection, therefore, to which of the seven will she be wife? For they all had her." But Jesus answered them, "You are wrong, because you know neither the scriptures nor the power of God. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. And as for the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what was said to you by God? I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. He is not God of the dead, but of the living." And when the crowd heard it, they were astonished at his teaching. This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
I've been through so many hard times, I can't explain it, no, I just don't know how. Why I have to go through so much pain, but take a look at me now, there's a blessing in his name. Don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Well, don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Now maybe you've been wondering, kind of feeling abused. You try to do the right thing, but you still get used. You just don't know why there should be so much pain. But if you made it here today, there's a blessing in your name. Don't you know that you made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Well, don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Now maybe you've been buked. Maybe you've been scorned. Gonna be a part of life just as sure as you're born. But if you trust in God as you go along the way, you see things will get better day by day. Don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Well, don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. world through sickness. I was healed by the wound in his side through sorrow. The joy of the Lord is my strength through heartache. He's never, ever left me alone. Depression, he'll ease the troubled mind. Don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Well, don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Well, let me tell you, through sickness, I was healed by the wound inside through sorrow. The joy of the Lord is my strength through heartache. He's never, ever left me alone. Depression, he'll ease your troubled mind. Don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Well, don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. No, don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Well, don't you know that I've made it? I'm so thankful, but I never could have made it. Made it this far without the Lord.
As we continue talking about what it means to be a resurrection people, today we want to look at what it means to be a resurrection people and to experience the change that comes to our lives because of our claims in Jesus Christ. Won't you pray with me? Move us, Lord, in your own way. Shape us after your will, that you might have your own way while we are yielded and still. You are the potter, Lord, and we are your clay. We give you thanks for all the grace you pour into our lives. Amen. There are competing priorities within our lives. There are two main competing priorities that shape the way we live from day to day. And those competing priorities are the need for stability and the need for change. We crave stability so that we know that we have something we can count on. We know that things won't go too far out of hand. But at the same time that we want stability, we also crave change because we don't want things to get too boring. We don't want things to stay broken. We want things to get better. Change, especially godly, holy change, starts from the inside and it goes all the way to the outside. And change is hard. Because change demands that we die to one thing so we can start to live into a new reality. And living into a new reality is hard too. Because it means that we have to let go of all those things we thought made us stable. Some of those things are just not going to make it anymore. So how do we experience change as God's people? How do we trust God enough to believe that through every change, God's love, God's grace, God's forgiveness, and God, God's self, remains the same? Now, the Sadducees came to Jesus, and they had a particular point in mind. They didn't believe in the resurrection. They thought that was a foolish, idle teaching. And they were determined to get Jesus in trouble, so they developed a gotcha question. They developed a question that they thought would confound him so much that it would prove that what he was teaching was false and ridiculous. So even though they did not believe in the resurrection, they asked him a resurrection question. And they asked a question that they knew there would be no answer so that they would leave him dumbfounded and speechless in front of the whole big crowd. Now, the book of Tobit, that's a book in the Apocrypha. It's not a book like in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, but it's considered a holy writ, but not included in our Bible. But if you get one of those big Bibles that has an Apocrypha, the book of Tobit is going to be back there. And in that book, there's a story that this question actually came from. The Sadducees asked, well, now there is a man and a woman. They got married. And, well, he died. She had no children. And our tradition is that if a woman is left widowed and there's no children involved, and if there are brothers, she marries the next brother. And so she married that next brother, but he died too. And she married the next brother. He died too. She went through seven brothers. And then finally she died. Since you believe in the resurrection, whose wife will she be? She married all seven of them. They asked the stupidest question they can find, because they believe in asking the stupid, ridiculous question, Jesus would have no answer. They didn't want change to happen. In particular, they didn't want the change that Jesus was bringing to the life of their city, the life of their culture, the life of their town. They didn't want to experience the change Jesus was bringing, so they said, let's stop him dead in his tracks right here, right now. And we know how they felt, don't we? How many times you tried to stop change in your life? How many times something new comes knocking at your door and your answer is, nobody's home? How many times has the church experienced something new, and as soon as something new comes to the church, everybody gets upset? They wanted it, but when it came, it was terrifying. How many times do you want your husband or wife to be different, and the minute they get different, it messes your world up? Because they done changed the mobile. Well, the Sadducees, their mobile was being shaken up, so they said, whose wife is she? Because they knew in their hearts, they knew that eternity comes through children. They said, if you have children, your children shall remember you. And as long as your family line goes on through children, you never really die. But in this case, seven brothers died, the woman died, and none of them had any children. So since you believe in the resurrection, how do you fix that up? How do you make that right? And of course, Jesus told them, you don't understand. You can't see because you're too caught up in trying to keep things the way they are. You're too stuck in doing things the same way you've always been doing them, and you're too caught up in sin. You don't want to lose your power. You don't want to lose your authority, and you don't want to lose your wealth. The Sadducees came from the wealthier classes. These were people who were pretty much set for their lives. They didn't worry about food to eat. They didn't worry about where they were going to live. They didn't worry about what they were going to wear. They had enough money and privilege and power to take care of all of that. And you know what happens when somebody threatens our privilege and power, right? The minute somebody says we need new roads, we say, okay. But then they say we got to raise taxes. What happens? I live with a pothole. I learn to drive around it. We don't want our lifestyles affected. We want new stuff, but just don't let the new mess with me. So Jesus said, if you really understood what was going on, if you really understood what God was trying to do in your life, you would understand that God's trying to set you free. You will understand that God's trying to give you a new thing, a new way that relieves you from the burden of thinking that this life is all there is. Relieve you from this idea that somehow when you die, all you do is go into the ground and rot away. God is trying to tell you that in the resurrection, there's no more marriage. Marriage is for this side of life. But on the other side of life, it's a brand new life like you've never known before. People will no longer be married and given in marriage. They will live something like what the angels live. They will live in a communion with me where everybody will be connected one to another. So when we die, when we go home, the bonds we've made here will be different. Now, I know I'm going to hurt somebody's feelings today, but this is scripture. This is not Donnell, okay? When you go to the other side, you will not be married to the one you were married to on this side. There is no more marriage on the other side. Life is different in God. Being married on this side gives you practice to learn to live with more folk on the other side. Learning to live with somebody 24/7, 365 on this side is teaching you how to give in, how to forgive, how to love, how to be graceful and merciful, how to practice justice on this side. So when you get to the other side, that becomes a natural way of life that you encounter everybody. Raising children on this side is teaching you how to be patient, change diapers, help somebody grow, help them become who God wants them to be, and learning how to let go when the time is right. So that when you get to the other side, you can let God be God. So you can be who God has called you to be. The Sadducees couldn't take that idea. They simply could not embrace it, because embracing it would mean they would have to give up their lives as they currently knew their lives. And God is calling us to that same challenge. We are being called to give up our lives as we currently know our lives, so that each day we can become more like Jesus. Every day we can grow more and more into his likeness. Every day we can be less and less afraid of losing, for every day we can take more and more of his victory into our lives. The victory of Jesus is one that never goes away. It doesn't wear out. It's not a trophy you get this year and have to earn it again next year. The victory is just being poured out. If we live victorious lives from day to day, being a little bit less afraid from day to day, we're able to live with a lot more joy in our lives from day to day. The killer of joy is not somebody else. The killer of joy is the fear we let rule our lives. Nobody kills joy for you. We do a good job of that all by ourselves. We kill our own joy every day. And Jesus is inviting us to know a joy that the world can't put down. You asked me a stupid question about marriage and resurrection because you think that you know what you're talking about. But you don't seek the wisdom that God's trying to pour out. You don't seek the love that God's trying to give you. You reject the grace that God wants to just lay out before you. And you want to keep things as they are. You know, the funny thing is that all of the turmoil we've been going through in our nation over these past, eight months? It all seems like things are changing, doesn't it? Like things are going away. We don't know how they're going to go, right? But if you really look at what's going on, you kind of notice that the ultimate goal seems to be not to move forward, but to go back to who we used to be. To go back to those days when certain folk felt comfortable because they were in the majority, to go back to a law and order society. When folk of a certain color could get arrested just for walking down the street at the wrong time. To go back. God is not a going back God. God pushes us forward. God moves us on. And God does it with so much grace and so much power and so much strength that we don't want to go back. So next time you find yourself tempted to say, oh, in the good old days of St. Matthew, there ain't no going back. Them good old days is gone. What stands before us right now is the good days God wants to bring. Ain't no use talking about how good it used to be, because used to be ain't no being no more. I know I said that kind of ugly, but sometimes you got to say it ugly. Just to make the point. What will be is what God wants for all of us. And what will be shall become the good old days for somebody else. So they can say, look back, and God can say, no, look forward. Because tomorrow is not promised. Today, yesterday is gone. So what you got is right here and right now. So let me love you right here and right now. So that when you come to tomorrow, you can say thank you for what is past. And thank you for what lies before me. And thank you for this moment that I got right here, Lord. It's a good day to be alive in God. You've been faithful all of my lives. So I trust that you're going to be faithful in what I do not know. So Lord, hold me and guide me. Make me ready for your kingdom. Because I want to live my life chasing after you. Because if I chase after you, I'm going to catch victory. If I chase after you, I'm going to taste glory. If I chase after you, I'm going to rise up and fly as if on the wings of eagles. If I chase after you, the world can't catch me. If I chase after you, if I run for my Jesus, I'm going to know a joy in the running that's so rich and so great that my life will be abundant no matter how much I got in the bank. And I'm going to rejoice and tell the world that my God is a good God who's pouring love out for all of God's people. In every change, I'm going to wait and see what new thing you're bringing into my life. And I'm going to rejoice and be glad that every time something different comes, I find a new level of grace to rest on. Going one level of grace to the next level of grace. That becomes my resting place. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.